California. And a red clay of Georgia.
What's up, everybody? Today is Friday, December 11th, 2020. This is A Talk in the Attic, episode number 82, in fact, of A Talk in the Attic. I'm your host, Kirk Ross, and my guest today is wonderful. His name is Edgar GRECH-CUMBO. He's a Maltese-American dual citizen, grew up in Clarkson, Detroit area, and in his early 30s, he got the itch to go full-on into the travel vibe. He's always enjoyed traveling. He had a lot of good experiences. People often told him, dude, why aren't you filming this? And so with that, he got himself armed with some cameras and some microphones, and he started collecting mass amounts of footage on a basically year-and-a-half-long trip around the world. Two trips around the world, technically. You'll hear more about that in the show. The outcome of these travels is a docu-series called Getting Worldly, which is available now on Amazon Prime. So if you're a Prime member, go to Prime Video. Check it out there for free. He's got three episodes up now, the first of which is when he went to Ukraine. The second is Georgia. He says in the episode, not Hotlanta, Georgia, but the country in the Middle East, Georgia. And finally, he went to Congo and Uganda in the third episode. So those are the three that are out now. He's got a lot more that he's working on. We talk a little bit about his production method. We talk a little bit about some of his travel experiences. Look, anything that I say now is going to be superfluous because there's enough energy, there's enough action, there's enough adventure in this episode without me blabbing on now. So let's get into this thing. Thanks to the Michigan Podcasting Network for your support. Thank you, Joe Gentleman, for the awesome theme song up top. Joe, I'm so excited for season 2's theme song. Start throwing some ideas around. That'll be coming out here in February. Folks, you're going to pick up midstream with Edgar and I in the middle of a conversation. I think I'm probably heaping praise on him when we enter because Jessica and I watched all three of his episodes over the last couple days, and we enjoyed it. It's unlike something you've seen. It really feels like someone you know telling you about trips that they went on. And I mean that in the most respectful and positive way. It's not overproduced. It feels raw. It feels authentic. And therefore, it's relatable. And it kind of makes you want to go to places that maybe you otherwise wouldn't want to. So if you're into getting tattooed by monks, getting rushed by a silverback gorilla in a forest that's literally called the Impenetrable Forest, sounds like something out of a Tolkien novel, but it's actually something at the Ugandan-Congolese border. What about getting jumped in Mexico City? It's all there. Tons of intrigue. What a fun time. Thank you so much, Edgar, for coming on. Folks at home, thank you for listening. Please, please, please subscribe and share. Send a link to this to a friend. If you could find some time to please write a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts, that goes a long way. And with that, let's jump into this conversation with Edgar GRECH-CUMBO, travel documentarian, responsible for Getting Worldly. It's on the film festival run right now, and it's available to you to watch. So go to the show notes, click the link, check it out tonight. Enjoy the show. But before you can enjoy the show, you know what we have to do. We have to start the show. So with that, let's start the show.
Well, I'm changing all my strings. I'm gonna write another traveling song about all the billion highways and the cities at the break of dawn. Well, I guess the best that I can do now is pretend that I've done nothing wrong and dream about a train that's gonna take me back where I belong.
It's got a very authentic feel to it. Like, it doesn't feel overproduced. It has a feeling of what someone that... And I don't mean that in a negative way whatsoever.
Raw.
I mean that in like a, you know, you see like a lot of these shows, a celebrity goes and talks to other celebrities in some fancy place. It's very much like what a real person is going to do on a trip, which is just such a great, you've captured it, man.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. And that's kind of what I was going for, you know, cause while I was working, I'd take trips for, you know, I'd go to Rio de Janeiro for the weekend and run around the favelas. And people would always be like, what the hell is that like? Or, you know, there was one weekend I saw on SportsCenter that they were letting Americans into Russia visa free. It's usually very difficult to get a visa there. Yeah. So I went to like Russia the next day and people were like, what do you do? You know, like what's it like? And so I was like, I should start filming this shit. You know, like, yeah, let
people
know.
What did
you
film it with? Yeah. On your iPhone primarily?
No, I have like 8 different cameras. You know, I've kept getting more and more and more. Now I have way more. I think the episodes you saw, yes, there was, you know, quite a few, some of it on my iPhone. And then I also have a few more cameras. Now I have a lot more professional cameras, but
well, dude, I think
yeah,
the appearance,
a drone.
It looks great. The drone footage is really cool.
They've done a
great job there too.
I've gotten that taken away in like 4 different countries. I had to fly to Israel 3 times to get it back. Yeah,
dude,
they took it.
I saw some story one time where they were the people, and I think it was Netherlands. The Amsterdam police force had trained like falcons to go capture drones out of the sky because it was illegal, like over the city limits or something.
I was pretty surprised too, because I did a lot of this filming like a year and a half ago, and there wasn't any like regulations or rules. They just let you whip a drone around like the sky. I was like, they need some laws on this, you know, because I'd be flinging it around. You know, I was in Palestine. There'd be like rockets flying above me. I'd have the drone going. They're like, hey, you know, that's enough.
That's
so, yeah, they took it. But yeah.
Well, so before we get into the show, because I have a lot of feedback on that, we've had a great time watching it. We've taken almost all of it down here.
Thank you.
Since we booked this interview just a couple days ago. So but let's talk a little bit about what led you there, you know. So you're not a videographer or a film guy by nature. I mean, maybe by nature, but not by career. So talk about kind of how that genesis started, and even if you want to start from when you were a little guy, maybe a little bit about your background and kind of get us up to where you started traveling,
you know. Basically just growing up in the Detroit area, you know, it was hurting around 2008. And what I ended up doing was I applied for just hoping to get a job for a Fortune 100 company, applied on the internet to Hewlett Packard. You know, at the time they were a Fortune 10 company, and begged them for a job. And they like, all right, kid, you know, move to Arkansas in a dry county. We'll give you a shot. I was like, all right, I'm going, you know, so I moved to Arkansas in a dry county. It sucked. It was not fun, but I worked my ass off for, 2 years to kind of work my way up the corporate ladder. Went from Hewlett Packard to IBM, then back to Hewlett Packard again. And then I got recruited by the Israelis. So kind of make a long story short, I just dedicated my career. I lived in Chicago, Arkansas, Denver. And then I got in a position where I could be an executive at HP. And they said, you know, where would you like to live? And I told them, I was like, I want to go to Detroit. And they thought I was joking. You know, it's like, no, I'm serious. You know, that's where I'm from. They're like, you don't want to go to Hawaii? You want to go to Detroit? They're all like, ha, 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 ha. You know, but yeah, so I decided to come home. And, you know, once I was making good money and everything, I always had a passion for traveling. I would just take a lot of trips, you know. So if there was a 3-day weekend, I'd be like, fuck it. I'm going to Machu Picchu this weekend, you know. And that's instead of watching Narcos, the documentary, I went to Medellin, Colombia, you know, ran around there for the weekend. So it's
I mean, did you have a wanderlust from when you were a kid? Did your parents, did your family travel, or what, you know, how did that all look when you were little? Like, we came from Bay City. We're just, you know, an hour north of where you grew up. Mm-hmm. And travel wasn't really, I mean, our idea of travel was kind of going to like sporting events on the weekend or whatever, or like whatever.
Yeah, you going downtown. Yeah,
exactly. Exactly.
Oh, that is an adventure.
You know? True.
Yeah. Especially back in the day, Detroit was definitely an adventure. Not so much now, but, I think where I got it, you know, it was just kind of an itch. I think the first time I went to Europe, I was, you know, 16 by myself, and went to Amsterdam, and then went to France. And, you know, when you start seeing all these places, it just kind of opens up your mind. I was like, I want more, you know. It's so much fun. And, you know, it's great meeting people and seeing different places and the experiences you have. And just ever since then, I just always kept traveling.
That's pretty incredible. So you got to the point where you were able to keep all, or start taking mass amounts of footage, obviously, that ultimately led to the creation of the docuseries. But yeah. Did there become a point where your kind of just basic travel became super focused, that like when you knew it was going to end up as this getting worldly docuseries, or did you kind of just do that afterwards once you'd already collected it?
Yes. Well, I mean, I decided to take a year off of work, and it was, you know, cause I was probably at the age of 30, you know, I was an executive at a Fortune 10 company at the time, making great money. It was like, all right, this is going to be my life. Probably going to get divorced 3 times. I'll make a lot of money, but you know, there's gotta be a little more to life than this, you know. It's way too materialistic. It's all I cared about. You know, I was like, you know, I think I'm going to step back and I'm gonna take a year off. You know, I can always come back to it, and I'm gonna travel and see the world. You know, I was tired of doing these weekend trips too, and so I was like, all right, well, if I do this, I can't just drink every night for a year.
You gotta have some focus or something.
Yeah, I was like, I gotta have something. I gotta do something. You know, keep me from getting in trouble. So yeah, I decided. I was like, give this a shot. You know, take a chance. And I was like, all right, I'll create a docuseries.
Dude, it's incredible. So how long? So you collected footage for an entire year. Do you have a year's worth of media to go through?
Yeah, I do.
How many countries does that cover?
I've been to 82 countries, but over the past year and a half, I went to about 40. And you know, it started off, I was like, I'm just gonna take a year off and do like a 7-month trip. So the thing you could do is you can book a ticket that actually goes around the world. It's called Around the World Flight. And you can stop at like 12 different countries. You have to do a full circle around the world. You have a year to use it, and you can't backtrack. So you have to continually go around the world. And so I did that, and that took about 7 months. And then I came back to Detroit, of all places. You know, it was just like, and I was just running around in Congo, you know, like.
Dude, we're just watching that episode. That was crazy.
Yeah, it was nuts, you know. And I was like, what am I doing here? And I was like, I'm not done. You know, I was like, I'm going to do it again. And so yeah. I did it again. It took another 8 months and did another circle around the world. And so, yeah, just between that little over a year, I was about 40 countries. And wow. Then.
That's crazy.
Trying to fire it back up here, but with COVID making it a little difficult. But
yeah, certainly. But you have citizenship and you have Maltese citizenship as well.
Yes, I just got my dual citizenship last year.
Congrats! Because that allows you. You would be you'd be home otherwise right now, probably, right? Well, Michigan, I should
could
say.
Come here. Well, even though I'm a dual citizen, like when I tried to come to Malta, I gave them a heads up, like the consulate and the embassy. It's like, hey guys, I'm coming. You know, is that okay? And they said, no, it's not. You know, I was like, I'm a dual citizen. I don't think maybe I didn't explain that well. I'm one of you guys, you know, like you're going to let me in, right? And they're like, no. And so if you're an American, you can't come to Europe, basically the entire EU. So I had to go to Turkey, Istanbul for like 2.5 weeks to quarantine. And that was a party.
I heard Istanbul was a party.
Dude, I had the most fun quarantining in the world. The currency crashed while I was there. So in January, it was basically like $1 to 6 lira. Lira is their currency. So right now it is like $1 to 11 lira. So like everything is more than half off. It was cheap like as it is, but now the currency crashed. And so everything was like free. I gained like 12 pounds while I was there. I was just eating just elaborate meals, buying drinks for everyone, you know?
So I mean, the currency crash worked out great for you, but very poorly for the yes. billion people that live in Turkey.
I felt bad. Yes, exactly. Dude, there's like 17 million people in Istanbul, you know?
No, isn't it? Yeah, don't they have more? Don't they have as many people in Turkey? Or no, maybe I missed. I was thinking they had almost as large of a population as the U.S.
No, what? U.S. is around like 340 million?
Yeah, 340 now.
I'm not sure how many.
It's a lot of people.
There's a ton. There's a ton of people. Yes, exactly.
And they know how to party.
Not even the capital.
Yeah, there's a lot of good, like EDM, there's a lot of good clubs going on in Istanbul. Maybe not during quarantine, but yeah.
Yeah. I was surprised just like you. You know, you've heard it's fun and everything, but it is a Muslim country too. So it's 99% Muslim. Right. And so, you know, I was like, I wonder how they're gonna, you know, think of me drinking nonstop. You know?
Yeah, they're partying Muslims.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. So they're a lot more laid back than a lot of other Middle Eastern countries. Yes. And their economy is just full of tourism. So they want people to come visit. Everyone should visit. It's cool.
Yeah, there's an endorsement. I'm sure you've, based on what I've seen from the show and just in talking with you this morning, it feels like you'd advocate for everyone to travel. You know, there's more. Oh, yeah. It's not just about getting the picture or making the docuseries or any of that. It's there's something spiritual that happens when you meet people from other cultures, right? That and you learn that they're the same as you. You know, there's different shit around it, but it's the same.
Mm-hmm. And you don't know what you don't know. So, you know, part of traveling too is just kind of figuring it out. And I don't know how much, you know, everyone relies on the media nowadays or how much truth you can get from it, but sometimes you just got to go and see it yourself, you know. And the thing that surprises me the most is how welcoming people are. And no matter what's going on in the country, I've been to a lot of countries that are in the middle of wars, you know, like numerous ones, and thinking that they wouldn't want an American there, but they love you. They just love anyone that's like, honestly, it would take the time to come see their country, see them, give it a chance, and see what you think of it. So meaning that always always kind of like breaks your heart almost, you know, the nicest people around the world, kind of, you know, gives you faith in humanity again.
Yeah, dude, I agree. And you did a good job of conveying that in the show, honestly. And I think I said raw, and I don't want anyone, first off, go check it out. There's going to be links in the show notes. Everyone, I mean, I think we're Prime members. I don't think we've paid for a Prime membership ever. I don't know if it's like an ex-wife's mother, my ex-mother-in-law. I think maybe you might have paid for it for a lifetime or something. But the point is you probably have it, even if you don't know you do. Go check the thing out. It's really cool. You'll get a feel for what I'm talking about when I say raw, because, and if you're watching a YouTube video, we'll be inserting clips here and there too. But there is a rawness to it that makes it so much more relatable and so much more realistic that I think the lessons in it just feel more less contrived. You know, it's not like some HGTV show or something like that where they go and they have some wrap up at the end. And really, you know, you were dealing with some personal stuff. We'll get into that a little bit with the death of your grandfather. And so that's in the show, which is very endearing and real. And I don't know, you did a great job capturing that. So I think we should talk about your process in that, because before we get to there, though, I want to go back to the travel agent part of me, which I've never been a travel agent, but I kind of, I've had a lot of bad travel agents, but, you get an around the world ticket and you have basically 7 months to complete it. Are you locked into certain dates and all you can do all the traveling you want around
you
there?
You can change them. Okay. So you have to pick your countries. You have to pick the countries, but you can change the dates. Yes. So it's kind of like, all right, what do I want to do? You know? So the first one I went to, oh man, I went to Australia. You know, I wanted to go surf in Australia. It seems pretty cool. I wanted to go to Thailand, get the tattoo. Then it was, I wanted to see Mount Everest. So I went to Nepal. And I wanted to meet the Sherpas that are on Mount Everest, you know, that actually like made different, you know, everyone's walking up there with oxygen. They don't walk with oxygen. They run up, carry everyone's bags. And then I actually got approved to meet the Dalai Lama. So,
oh, the Dalai. Did you meet him? The Lama?
His Holiness. No, I didn't get to. So I flew to India after that. But I got approved. He got really sick a year and a half ago, and he canceled all meetings for like 4 months. He almost died. Mm-hmm. But so I found myself in India just being like, well, I was here to meet the Dalai Lama, but you know, they didn't get to, but went to Lebanon. Yeah, from Lebanon, went to Egypt, then to Rwanda, Uganda, Congo, South Africa, Ghana. And that was the first trip. And then, you know, back to America.
And so, I mean, you probably don't have a favorite, but what are all those countries you named are very different, obviously.
Yeah.
So give a little kind of a snapshot of the biggest difference you notice from one place to another. And then also the kind of what a common thread was that you recognize amongst all of those. And maybe we already covered that, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it was your first question. What was I probably don't have a favorite, but I have like a handful of favorites.
Yeah. Let's hear them. You know, yeah.
If I could, what I usually say is like, if I could live anywhere else, Japan, number one, Japan's awesome. You know, Tokyo's the largest city in the world. It's also the most cleanest city, and you can do like anything you want.
Yeah, dude, that's my favorite city too.
Yeah, they've already thought of the most efficient way to do it too. You know, and it's just like, yeah, they figure it out. They're very dedicated. That and Lebanon in Israel, I really liked. Rio de Janeiro is, you know, these are all very different regions too. Rio de Janeiro is just magical. You have like, you know, the ocean, you have the mountains, you have the jungle, you have the favelas. It's dangerous, it's scary, but it's fun, and the women are beautiful.
Yeah.
And actually, Russia, I really liked Russia too. Russia was really cool. But I think the biggest difference is just, I guess, in regions, you know, what people say is people like to say like a third world country. That really doesn't make sense. That's just from like World War II, basically. But so it's like developed countries and non-developed countries.
Right.
You know, so when you're in the Western world, anything that's like, you know, Western Europe, the Americas, everything else, things are kind of standard. Australia. But once you start getting into like non-developed countries, that's where it's fun. You know, it's just like anything goes. It's nuts. It's so cheap and it's great. I like it. You know.
Well, you're talking about the Congolese air travel scene, and it didn't sound very reassuring. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, man, in Congo, it's like it's dangerous to fly. Like snakes on a plane is real. It happened there. Like they find snakes on a plane often, and like someone actually brought on like an alligator too. But
that caused like a crash, like a mass casualty.
Yes, 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 exactly. It did.
Yeah, you talked about it in the show. Yeah, that's tragic. It sounds like a funny beginning, a funny premise, and then it sounds very sad at the end of it.
No, and it's real. You know, yeah, it's just anything goes there. I mean, that place is so dangerous too. You know, and it's just the historical aspect of it is kind of fascinating too. You know, out of all the places I've been, that's, I think it's probably the most dangerous place in the world. That's not in like a straight out war, but they constantly are in war. Everyone's fighting over the minerals there. And, yeah, you know, the children soldiers too. It's just, it's crazy.
Yeah. You, I mean, I love, we love the aspect of history that you brought to the show as well.
I try not to be too geeky with it, but it's interesting though, right?
No, I think it's, yeah. That was our favorite part of it. Honestly, like you talked about Joseph Kony and that one in Georgia, you talked to, I forget what was the historical part you got into with Georgia. Well, you talk a lot about Stalin's yeah. whole thing. And then of course, in the first one, you talk about the
war with Russia.
Well, yeah, a 4 million person nation with like virtually no real armory going up against Russia.
It'd be like Maine going up against Russia. They're like, you know. Right.
Yeah, that's exactly.
You guys aren't going to win this one. They know it too, you know. But yeah.
You got to keep an eye on Maine, by the way.
Yeah. How so?
Well, I mean, they're always ready to throw down, it seems like. No, I'm joking.
So is Michigan, huh? there's a militia there.
True. They just tried to kidnap the governor, for God's sake.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh my goodness. What a great time to be in Malta, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah. It is. It's open too.
Is it?
So like the bars are open, everything. It's like the only country in Europe right now it's open. So it's great. I like it.
So what are you doing there right now? Are you living there? You talk about in one of the episodes, you showed some footage of going out with your grandfather. It was the last time you hung out with him.
Yeah.
And he made you promise over and over that you'd go see Malta because you guys are Maltese. So talk about that.
Well, he wanted me to tell his sister, you know, like who's going to tell her that she passed away, you know, the family and everything. And, yeah, I mean, he promised him that I'd do it. So, you know, I also felt obligated to. My grandpa would talk to her once a week. And so, you know, God forbid that she would just think my grandpa just stopped loving her or something and just stops calling, you know.
Right.
So I wanted to give her some closure to it too. You know, and once I came back here, I've been here probably 8 times before. And, you know, I love it. It's just, it's a different lifestyle. You know, I love America, of course, but, I also love it here too. I have, you know, all my relatives are here. It's a small island. It's about 350,000 citizens. You know, it's very small, but, it's cool. And it's nice. It's just a laid back life.
And so it's kind of like between Morocco and Italy or something.
Where exactly
is it?
Yes. Yeah. I'm impressed, man.
But it's only because I looked it up. It's only because I looked it up yesterday. Yeah, no, I didn't have that in the back of my head. But so is it more of an African vibe or more of a European vibe, or is it really just
European
a super
vibe for sure?
European
good
vibe.
Question. Yeah. Yeah, the language is kind of a mixture of Arabic and Italian, so it's tough. I'm gonna have to learn it. Start taking language classes next week. But yeah,
do you have anything?
It's definitely a European vibe. What's
do
that?
Do you have any Maltese down?
No, not at all.
No,
like Kifnit, basically, how are you?
I'm well. Thanks for asking, actually. Nihongo ga sukoshi wakarimasu ka?
Whoa, you speak Japanese?
Sukoshi wakarimasu. Only a very little tiny bit. Okay. I basically learned the first CD of Pimsleur's, and that teaches you, this is funny, actually. It teaches you how to say Nihongo ga sukoshi wakarimasu demo mata josu jarimasen, which means exactly. That's the problem. So I have it perfectly. I have the accent and everything. It's perfect, but it literally means I only know a little bit of Japanese, but I'm learning. And so then the next question is inevitably like, well, how much Japanese? And I literally don't know anything else. So I'll just kind of give like the, you know, so I basically can say
one thing.
You've
been to Japan too?
I have. I've been there a dozen times or so for work though. So,
awesome.
But I've, you know, so my wife Jessica has never been. And now that I'm out of the auto industry, I want to go back there in like a purely tourist, you know, vibe.
Yes.
Because it's very different when you're there working, but I do love it. The great part about Tokyo, and also the very frustrating part about Tokyo, is there's not a trash can in sight. So at first, if you're just a American who's used to throwing shit away, it's problematic. You end up loading your bag and your pockets up. But what it ultimately teaches you is like, don't buy shit that you have to throw away.
Exactly. Yeah.
So there's
don't
no
walk
littering.
Out of your house. You have shit. Yeah. Like, right. Keep your shit inside. Don't bring it out for like, you know, to throw away. I walked around Tokyo for like 2 hours with like a Red Bull can, being like, finally had to ask someone at 7-Eleven, like, can I use your trash can? You know, because there really is no trash cans there.
Yeah, and it's clean and it's beautiful.
Yes. Man. Yeah.
And I noticed, I mean, when I go to a place for the first time, even if it's an American city, I always like trying to get on the mass transit system because I just feel like you really get a feel for the real people, you know. But so what's your favorite mass transit system that you've seen? And we'll give a couple anecdotes that you've seen out there that are probably a little hairy.
Yeah, definitely had some like horrible ones, but excuse me, sorry. That's one thing that like man, even in India is, it's not my cup of tea. It's huge, you know, so it's way too hard to generalize India. It's way too big, but like, it's kind of gross. You
it's
know,
dirty. It's very like, dirty in a lot of places. Yeah, the water
exactly.
smells.
It's very dirty. Yeah. Yep, nothing works. But somehow, like, they got their mass transit like down pretty good in some parts, like the metro. But like, yeah, and if you take like the long haul train, there's people like sleeping on top of each other. But their metro is extremely surprising. It's air conditioned. It's like, wow,
yeah,
you guys actually got this right, you know. But the most beautiful one I've seen is probably Moscow. Moscow is incredible, you know, and it's there's like all stolen treasures from around the world. And they like decorate their metros with it. So like one of the main things to do when you get into Moscow is you go around the metro and you see all the different stations and like treasures from around the world that they've conquered people, and like they put it up on display for them. You know, it's like, oh, all right.
Like, yeah, skull, also love, like skulls of former leaders, or what is it, what kind of stuff?
No, like jewels and diamonds and marbles and like paintings, and I don't know. It's just, it's beautiful. It's like, wow. You know, I've never seen like an investment like this in, you know, transit.
In a public transit. Yeah.
Yeah. Japan's is awesome. You know, if they're running like a minute late, they write you a note, you know.
It never happens, dude.
I
remember one time I was in Hiroshima and there was a typhoon coming or something, and they closed the trains for like an hour, and I was mm-hmm. just, people were beside themselves, you know. I hadn't like,
oh yeah,
never happened, you know.
Yeah, man, I love the Japanese people though. How about you?
Oh yeah, dude, I love, yeah, they're you great. Know, you talked about in your series about how in America we're materialistic, or you know, we're very focused. You didn't say that. We're very focused on work and our job and our how we make our living, and
live to work.
I around when I was 35, I had the same awakening that you had at 30, which is like, I worked hard, I was making good money. I kind of started to feel like a fraud kind of there, because I was just like, I don't really care about this shit anymore. Like, I don't want to care about like all this stuff anymore.
I did it.
Exactly. And so I left as well, but I didn't go on a year-long travel around the world. That's for sure. But
it's all right. You probably saved some money.
Yeah, right. So I completely was jibing with you on what you were saying about that. But that said, the Japanese people, at least the males, you know, because it's still very, very traditional in that way, the males are very focused on their job. In fact, getting let go in Japan from your job is more like akin to like a divorce or something in the U.S. in terms of what it does to you.
I bet.
And so I remember when I first traveled there, it was really my first real culture shock, where I had traveled a little bit, but never to anywhere too far outside of my white European background kind of thing, you know? And so I remember being there, and I was kind of saddened by how heavily they were into their work. But by the end of that trip, I realized like, no, that it's just a different thing. But at the end of the day, it's still about the family. They all go out after work together, and you know,
yeah,
it's different. They have different emphasis there. But like you said, and like we talked about earlier, it's like they're very similar to us, but they're disciplined. They're quiet.
Truly disciplined, dedicated. Yeah. Dedicated, quiet. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's like calming there. Courteous, it's relaxing.
Yeah, it is. It is. And I just have a lot of respect for them. You know, anyone that anything they do, they kind of perfect. So it's like, you want something in Japan, it's perfected, basically. You know, it's usually good stuff. If you just want noodles, you know, you can pick any, you know, shithole in the wall place but they're going to have like the best noodles possible too. You know, it's great.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. I went to this blowfish place, Fuga. I think it's called Fuga. And it's like, you know, it's the one that you need like a certification. Otherwise, if you eat the wrong part of it, you can like die of shock or something. Oh. But like, apparently now they grow these suckers in farms. So like they're growing without toxins, but they don't tell you that. But I remember going there, and we had like an 8-course meal, all these blowfish 8 ways or something. And it was one guy working. It was his restaurant. We were the only customers there. And you would have thought we were like royalty or something. And I think it cost
$30
a piece or something. But it was like, wow, they put so much of their energy into it. Everybody takes their job seriously. It's really something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you eat Kobe beef while you were there too?
I did. I think actually we have a mutual friend. We were connected through Zach Domitz.
Yes.
Another Clarkston native, Detroit native. And Zach and I went to a shabu shabu place one time, and I think we ended up ordering some Kobe beef, but we got cut off by the Japanese because we're these two giant Americans just crushing beers and eating all you can eat food. And they ended up telling us that it was only pork left. Only pork left. No more beef. So we're like, fine, bring out more pork. We're eating the pork, and then and then we saw them walk by with a bunch of more beef just to other tables, you know. It was like, we got cut off.
Yes, they like to keep it to themselves. You know, it's like, and they actually can't import it. So like America, maybe they say they have Kobe beef. They don't have the real Kobe beef. It's only in Japan, right. You know?
Well, they massage those suckers.
Dude, like, they massage them. They give them beer. They, you know, they live a great life.
Dude, yeah. We have to get into your spot, your Georgian bathhouse. That story had me on the floor laughing. So,
yeah.
talk about your scrub down, the whole vibe.
Well, yeah, in the episode, you know, one of the things to do in Georgia is like you go to the bathhouse. So I was like, whatever, yeah, I'll do it. You know, wasn't sure what to expect, but yeah, it was just uncomfortable, man. You know? So you walk in there, you get naked, you get in this little pool, and I was thinking, like, sorry if I sound like a pervert or a man, whatever. I'm like, maybe some hot chick comes in and scrubs me. I'm like, this will be great.
Well, you know? they asked you up front at the front desk, do you want for extra money? Do you want to be scrubbed?
Yeah, yeah. So it's like, yeah, of course, you know,
yeah,
like,
sure, I'll take it scrubbed. Yeah,
yeah. It was like the most humiliating, degrading thing in the world. You know, I'm sitting there and I'm ready for it, and like some 70-year-old man comes in a Speedo and he's like, all right, let's go, buddy. You know, and has me lay down there and he scrubs like every inch of your body. And I'm just laying there like, this is just so uncomfortable. But, you know, hey, part of traveling, it's normal for them. And they're down with it. You know, I went when I was in Istanbul a couple weeks ago, like a Turkish bath is a famous thing to do. Yeah. And I was like, here we go again, man. It was a lot more, pleasant than the,
you ordered the scrub down again from the 70-year-old
yes.
man.
Yeah, no, I did not. They had like a beautiful Turkish lady give me a scrub down. That's it worked out better this time. Yes, yeah.
Georgia was beautiful. I don't know much about Georgia.
Isn't it?
I know a lot more now having watched your second episode. So what
the scenery there is just amazing. There.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, it's cool, man. I mean, it is so small, but if anyone likes hiking, if anyone, you know, if you're down for hikes and great food that's cheap and you love wine, like go to Georgia. You know, that's it. That's the place to go. You know, dude, beautiful women, beautiful mountains. Yeah.
What was that? What was that dish that you were on the search for that you finally found? That shit looked good, man. Yeah. Especially the one where
good.
Were you the one where you finally hit the jackpot? I was like, oh, yes. This looks better. The other ones just look like pizzas, but this one
pizza. That's exactly what it was. Yeah, I kept looking for it. You know, because it's like the famous dish in Georgia, and it's they sell it everywhere, and it's like you got to try this. And so yeah, finally I nailed it. Finally I got it. It's it's so good. It's cheese, egg, bread. I forget the name of it is, but yeah, it's great. But it's funny you saw that. Yeah, I was definitely on the look for it. You know,
yeah, dude.
I was searching for it.
So are you? So let's talk about the actual project now. Getting worldly.
It's killing it in the film festival circuit. It's won quite a few. I think I won one in Wales a couple weeks ago. One in Las Vegas, and then another one called Phenomenal Film Fest. So it's getting some great attention. So hopefully, kind of what they do, my ultimate goal would be hopefully people can watch this on Netflix one day. But right. Before Netflix even looks at it, they're like, okay, how did you do on the film circuit? And which is supposed to be like a very fun thing to do too, you know, because when you get accepted to these film fests, they fly you out. Yeah, you get to go. And, you know, you have a bunch of drinks on the red carpet and you have a blast, you know. And but since it's COVID, it's just like this. It's someone interviewing me on a computer screen. So I'm not getting drunk and running around on the red carpet or anything, but
what a shame. You can't go get drunk and run around. You can't get drunk and run around in a bunch of cool places as you're promoting a show in which you're getting drunk and running around in a bunch of cool places. What a shame.
Yes, exactly. It's all I wanted, man. It's all I wanted. Yeah.
Things will come back to normal, I imagine, at some point. But
yes.
So the film festival circuit this year is literally all remote where you're how do you watch that? So do you have access to watch all of them somehow, like through
an
easy interface?
Yeah, it's pretty much. They use a lot of social media, and yeah, basically it's just like you said. Yeah, it's an easy interface. Every film festival kind of does it a little different. Some countries are open, but they won't allow you to travel there. So I think in Austria last week, it was just at the Austrian International Film Festival, and they had it in an actual theater. One in Ukraine, they showed the episode of Ukraine there, which was fun. They loved it.
That's awesome. That's cool. That I could really tell when you were watching it that you wrote the narration, you know, with very much in mind that you know you're respecting the people there, and that comes through. Hopefully. You know, yeah,
you know, because like when you think of Ukraine, it's like I don't know about this place.
it's unknown. You did a good job of encapsulating. Like, what the fuck is this place?
Yeah, what is when you got? You know, I've heard some crazy shit here. You guys get weird. You know, yeah, and it was weird. You know, I was ripping shots of absinthe. I rented a tank You know, I was doing donuts with a tank. Go to Chernobyl. Yeah, I had a blast, man. But the people there were so cool and they were so nice. And I thought it was gonna be dangerous. It's not dangerous at all. It's very safe. It's cool, you know, and you really feel for them too. They're at war with, you know, Russia right now. That's taken over, you know, a big part of the country. And so I definitely wanted to be respectful to them too, but yeah, still tell the truth, you know, like, yeah, there's some weird shit here.
Yeah, you do a good job of distancing, you know, that kind of comment and making it clear that it's coming from your own perspective and that you're not broadcasting some sort of generality. You do a good job writing it in that regard for sure.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah. So I think anyone, any country that you end up doing an episode on will probably enjoy watching it. I would imagine, you know.
Awesome. But, yeah. I hope so. Thank you.
But that said, now as a business person, it does make sense. Any press is good press, and there's no way to get good press and to get start, you know, some sort of culture war in another country. So maybe you should consider doing a really disrespectful one at some point.
I considered it in Romania.
We'll be back right after this short break.
And it kind of goes like this. It's kind of 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Talk in every telephone, get eaten off the web. Must rip out all the epilogues in the books that we have read. Into the face of every criminal, strapped firmly to a chair. We must stare, we must stare, we must stare. We must take all of the medicines to expensive.
Any press is good press, and there's no way to get good press to get good press and to get start, you know, some sort of culture war in another country. So maybe you should consider doing a really disrespectful one at some point.
I considered it in Romania. I was like, oh man.
Not a great experience?
Giving it to them. I had a good experience, but I went there for Halloween. And so I was like, in my head, I'm like, this is going to be awesome. Vampire, you know, I'm going to go to Dracula's. Yeah. I'm like, I'm going to Dracula's castle. I'm going to have a huge party there. Like, and I'm like, I got to be something American, but low key American, because it's going to piss everyone off. You know, like I can't be Trump or I can't be like Bill Clinton or anything, but I'm like, what is Elvis? Who, like, that's American. Hell and, yeah, you know, like, who doesn't love Elvis? And then I got there. I got like cold feet too, man. I started getting self-conscious. You know, like, what if they don't know who Elvis is? Oh, God. You know, I'm in Romania here. It's weird. You know, they're not going to know who Elvis is.
And you're thinking, but, I spent 48 hours consecutively working on my pelvic thrust and now for nothing.
Yeah. Dude, it was awesome. But I get to Dracula's castle. We had a big party there on Halloween night, which was just awesome. It was cool. They don't really dress up for Halloween. I was the only person dressed up. Like, so it was kind of like going to Disney World and dressing up like Mickey Mouse, you know, like people were like giving me hold their kids and they were taking pictures with me and stuff. It was like, I think they thought I worked there or something. I don't know. But
Does this guy think that we think that's his real hair or what's going on with this guy?
No, they're like Elvis Presley. They don't speak any English, but they love Elvis. So it worked out great.
The universal appeal.
Mm-hmm. The thing that I didn't like about it was, like, there's so many scams. And then, so going to Dracula's castle, and it's like, all right, it's called Bron Castle. And then you find out it's not the real Dracula's castle. There is a real Dracula's castle, but it's different. They just call this one Dracula's castle because Dracula was a fictional character.
Yeah.
So it's just like, oh, you assholes. You know, like, I just went across Romania for nothing to come to your, like, your fake Dracula castle. Yeah, and the real one is like on the other side of the country. So it was like, oh man, you got me. Yeah.
Oh shit. So how many, you have 3 episodes released now. Is your mm-hmm. intention to get through the festival circuit and to produce more? Or are you making,
yes, exactly.
Are you self-producing it as well, doing all the editing and all that? Dude.
Yes.
That's inspiring, dude. Like, for me as well, because this podcast is very much a one-man show too. And that's not to say I don't have wonderful support from my wife and stuff and friends, but I'm doing all the aspects of it myself. And a lot of people have told me they're inspired by that. But dude, you're out there, you're on Amazon, like anyone in the world can go watch you and get it yourself. There's like, the point is, people think they shouldn't start something because they don't know the right people or whatever. You don't need to know anyone. You
Take
are
a
the
fucking
person
chance.
Do it, right?
Yes, exactly. You know, and like you said, it is, it's raw, but it's real. And I think like you also said too, you know, like, people appreciate that, and it gives, it's not an overproduced thing too. So it kind of gives a real view of what it's like. And just like with your show too, you know, like, this is how you do it. You know, it's doing it yourself too. And I think when people have so much help and everything else and it's so overproduced, that kind of loses a little bit of appeal, you know. Dude, I like stuff that's real.
Yeah, 100%. And especially, the reality is a lot of people are intimidated by travel already because it's expensive and all of that. And so when you see like these kind of overproduced shows where it's all laid out and they're all, it's always these curated events and things like that, it's really never, you know, that doesn't help people at all. That's not going to help anyone like get over their fear of like, oh no, what's a real person going to do when they get there? Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you ended up in Uganda. Basically, I mean, that whole trip looked pretty scary because you were getting in unmarked cabs and, you know, it ended up being a good experience, but.
Yeah. It ended up being a good experience, but yeah, I got a little shaky there. Yeah, man, that could have easily gone really, really bad, you know? And I thought it wasn't get bad. And we were crossing the border there too. Like, sometimes I get nervous pulling out this camera. You know, everyone's staring at me. I'm in the middle of, you know, I'm on the border of Uganda, Congo, and Rwanda. And it's just like, I stick out like a sore thumb, all white. And they're like, and this guy's going to film us right now. Like, you got some balls, kid. You know, like, we're about to steal everything you have. You know?
Yeah.
But, yes, sorry, I'm not sure if that cut in or not. People kept calling my phone.
Oh, no, it was, if you have to take it, you can take it if you need to.
No. But I wasn't sure if you could hear that on the line.
Yeah, no, I didn't. It came across on my side, so.
Good. Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah, dude, and then you got to go see the gorillas. You had had a hairy situation. I don't mean that as a pun, but it got hairy there with those.
Yeah, man, one charged at me, but yeah. I mean, it's just incredible. Those things are going, they're incredibly extinct. You know, anyone that's familiar with Diane Fossey, you know, it's incredible. It's the only place in the world you can see them. It's great. And they allow permits, you know, I think like 8 or so a day. And it's, you're in the shit there. I mean, it's as real as it gets, you know, and you have probably like 20 different people with AK-47s around you because you're going in there. You could run into a rebel group. You could, you know, get charged at by an elephant, or you know,
like, no. Like when you were asking your reporter about if there were elephants, and they were just so enamored with your camera phone that they were, or like with your camera, they weren't even paying attention. Like, and then it was funny because after that you said something like, I could have talked to these guys all day, and I made a joke to my wife like, well, you better put the camera away because they're just distracted right now if you're gonna keep talking to them. But yeah, you're trying to ask them like, are there elephants down there? And they're like, what?
They didn't care at all what I was saying. They were like, just amazed, looking at the phone. They're like, this is me, you know, like, yeah.
Jessica kept saying like, this guy's trying to get a girlfriend off the show. Cause he was like, looking at the camera, like, I think his name was cool. Ram. Dude,
that was awesome. Yeah. Ram. Yep. He was awesome. Yeah. Oh man.
I have a question for you. And this isn't to challenge you. Cause I agree, you brought awareness to the endangerment and to that culture. And that's wonderful. But does it ever create, when you take humans into that environment, does it ever create the need for those guides to kill an animal? You know what I mean? Like, do they ever kill one of these endangered apes for them charging?
No.
No. Okay.
They probably keep that.
They would keep that quiet.
On DL. Not they would tell us about that. Yeah. I've never heard of one, but that's also like the biggest revenue generating thing in the country. They're like one of the most poor countries in the world, Uganda. And so like that, just that little amount of tourism it brings is so much money that if they came out and were like, yeah, these girls will kill you. Like, I don't think they'd shoot themselves in the foot like that, but
yeah, dude, those things are beautiful, man. That was an incredible, wow.
Oh, it's so cool. And then when you get there, it's like, you know, I had such expectations and you get there and you kind of just, you just stare at each other for like an hour. You know, it's like,
all right. Feeling each other out kind of.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, one of the little baby girls, you know, was like, wanted to play, came up and like started grabbing at my shoes and stuff, and it was like, I just had to stand still. All I wanted to do was just like give it a little hug or tickle it or something, you know, like, yeah, exactly.
I mean, do they tell you not to do that because the mom or dad will come fuck you up? Yeah,
that, but also you can get them sick, and like, because we can get them sick, you know, just because they're not used to, I don't know, whatever crazy disease we're carrying around with us. Yeah, and so you can't touch them, and but the rebels, they actually do kidnap people on those trips.
Yeah, dude. I mean, did you feel more like, I know in Europe and in some Middle Eastern countries, people feel like Americans are more targeted. I have a friend who travels and he would sometimes carry Canadian cash back when things were like kind of,
I don't, I mean, I've lived in Detroit for the past 15 years. Like,
you can make it through there. You can make it through
anywhere. Yeah, exactly, man. I'm not too scared of it. You know, like, people don't hate Americans that much, but people say like, yeah, you should say you're Canadian. I never do. I always say it's America. I want to say I'm American, so people have a good impression on America. Yeah. You know, you kind of represent the country too when you're there. So if they do have any viewpoints, it's like, you know, or they're upset, it's like, all right, let's talk about it.
Yeah, of course.
Maybe I could change your mind or something. You know, maybe you can learn from me too. You know?
I think in the case of like some sort of organized criminality, in that case, you know, mm-hmm. Americans would actually be unattractive to because we'll yes, you know we're a little
exactly.
bit we'll I fuck think, you up a little bit harder than other places. Might.
I think you're basically protected anywhere in the world just because, you know, if you fuck with it, tourism is so big, and no matter what country you're in, someone runs your hood. You know, there is some sort of organized crime that right. comes in, and if you kidnap an American or you kill an American, you're bringing heat on the entire neighborhood. You know, you're fucking up the man's business. And yeah. so, you know, you'll have to, there will be consequences for it. But I feel like you're protected basically anywhere because of that, except Mexico City, just because Mexico City is just too chaotic and nuts. And like, no one's accountable because everyone's in, you know, all the high up guys are on the run, you know, running around Mexico, probably living in like a cave or something, but have billions of dollars. And right. then all the middlemen are constantly getting killed. And so it's just like a kind of a free for all. They will kill you. Yeah.
You had a negative experience. You kind of had a scary yeah, situation in Mexico. You got carjacked, right?
Yes.
With Latile yeah. out of here. I want to know.
Yeah. I could see it coming too. Excuse me. So what's happening was, it's not like I was coming back from like the titty bar at 2 a.m.
I was going to the titty bar and it was 2 p.m.
Yeah. Yes. I wasn't coming back. I was going to. Yeah. So I was going to the airport and I was leaving Mexico City. And it's a cool place. I mean, it's the largest city in the Americas. So it's huge. You
it's a
know?
Cool city. Like, I mean, it's beautiful too. Yeah. Like down in like the embassy kind of area. It's beautiful.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. On the way to the airport, we started going to, I was in an Uber. We're going down a single lane, one way road. And it was just like, oh, this is not good. You know, like growing up in Detroit, they tell you, you know, you should leave enough room between you and the car ahead of you just in case, you know, you need to pull out and get out. But on a single lane road, you're a sitting duck. You can't go anywhere. You're boxed yeah. in with traffic. Oh. And so it was just like, all right, this is not good. This is like, you know, we are sitting ducks. This is prime for something. So I had a feeling it was coming. It was just like, all right, when is it coming? Sure enough, three guys come up to, you know, with the shirts over their face, like, you know, and, I was like, all right, you know, how bad is this? Do they have a gun? And I was like, they don't have a gun. But then I was like, who robs somebody without a gun? You know, I was like almost insulted. Like,
I'm an honestly, American, damn it. If you're going to rob me, you better have a gun.
What are you going to do? Beat me up? You know, like, fuck you. Who cares? Do it. So what? You know? Yeah. I was like, but I had, you know, a suitcase, probably $5,000 worth of stuff on me, just right. of like possessions. I was like, how stupid it sounds, but in my head, my first initial thought was like, I got this. You know, I was like, I'm not going to beat them all up, but I was like, oh, there's no way that you guys are like, I'm giving this stuff up. You know, I was like, think again, you know, but so they come on and they beat up my, my cab driver and take all his stuff, his phone, his GPS, everything. And they look at me and they're like, phone, camera, bag, wallet. I was like, no, I was ready too. I was like, oh,
you're ready to die? I was just ready. Or you knew they would have no, guns.
Basically, but they didn't have a gun. So I was like, you know, who cares? Beat me up. So what? You know, whatever. And so
that's
like
a good guy story.
He jumped at me and I hit him as hard as I could. And once I hit him, his shirt fell down to his face and he had 6 teardrop tattoos on his eyes. And it was like, after I did that, I was like, oh my God, you know, like this guy's killed people. Like, of course they have a gun. You know, I was like, this is not good. Another guy came to the back seat. I have scars on my leg from it. He brought out I don't know if it was like a pocket knife or like a box cutter or something, but he was like the size of me. I'm not a big guy. I'm 5'6", 150, you know, I'm small. And so I was like, whatever, you know, like, I don't care about that. I'm scared about the guy with the, you know, the teardrop tattoos. And so I kept wailing on him. This guy just kept slicing my legs up, still have scars on my legs from it, you know? So I'm bleeding. I'll give you footage of it after too. You can see me. My shirt's all ripped up. I got like, one guy's scratching me and stuff. It was an intense fight in the backseat of this cab. And then the third guy comes up and I'm like, all right, time to get out of here with my bags. And I get out of the back seat and he puts a gun to my head. And like, I had to accept that I was dead. You know, like I just, you know, fucked up one of their buddies and I didn't give up any of my stuff. They'll kill me for sure. You know, and it's crazy what goes through your head when, you know, I had to just accept that I was going to get shot in the face. You know, the first thing I thought of was like, oh, my poor mother. You know, I was like, oh, she's not deserve that. She's going to hear that I got shot, and, you know, in the head and died in Mexico City. You know, I was like, I was an asshole. I should have just given it up. You know, obviously I made the wrong decision, but like,
right.
You know, it was like accountability, you know, like I asked for this. you know, and now it's time to pay the price. And one of the guys in the back seat, the little mother effer that kept cutting up my legs, grabbed my gold chain and ripped it off. And I grabbed it like this, still the same one I'm wearing.
The big cross, the big cross. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, so what happened was, it broke and I had a crucifix on it. The crucifix fell off. And so once the crucifix fell off, he grabbed the crucifix, you know, I had the gold chain in my hand and they all just ran. So I'm sitting there with like my bags in one hand, my chain in the other hand. And there's like 300 people just around like, we thought he was going to shoot you. You know, like you are so lucky.
Nobody was intervening.
Oh man. Well, I wouldn't intervene either. If someone's got a gun, you know, it's like, what? They don't want to get shot. So I get it. You know, I probably wouldn't have been wise to intervene. Yeah. They would have got shot. Fair. But yeah, they were just like, yeah, everyone's shocked. I threw my stuff in my bags and then we're still in traffic. So it was like, all right, I didn't lose anything. I lost a crucifix. And my cab driver, he's crying. You'll see it in the video. he's crying. I'm like, just go to the airport. I had to pull up directions on my phone because they took his GPS and everything too. But, you know, and it was just like, that was the only scary part was like, okay, they're coming back. They're coming back because one, like I messed one of them up and two, they didn't get anything from me. So I have all my stuff. So either for, you know, me hurting that guy's pride or to get my stuff, they're coming back though.
Well, and
so
you could identify him now too, because his face mask came down or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. All of them. But, yeah. There's some amigo out there too. When I punched the guy, I was like, oh man, I'm gonna knock him out because I got the first shot. I was thinking for sure I'm gonna knock this guy out, and it was like the biggest miss. And you're like, it's difficult to
haymaker all the emotions and you just missed. Oh, no control.
Biggest haymaker. Yeah. Biggest haymaker. So I missed his chin and I hit him in the ear.
Oh, that would hurt.
Some amigo's ear is still ringing to this day in Mexico City, man.
Okay.
It's hurting. Yeah. Yeah. But so I got my chain, but I got the crucifix. I was like, you know what? Fuck them. I wanted a bigger one anyway. So I went out and bought a bigger crucifix.
Yeah, there you go.
You can have it.
Upgraded your Christianity accordingly. That's what happens when you get beat up like that. Or whatever. Yes. You get stabbed a bunch of times by a box cutter.
I don't know what it was, man. Yeah. They got me good though.
Did you have to go get medical attention?
No. Like I had to catch my flight. I was like, I'm getting out of here. God. You know, I was like, I could. And like, at one point, the police stopped us, and they were like, you know, would you like to make a report? And I was like, oh, God, no. You know, like.
That sounds even more dangerous, yeah.
Yes, exactly. It is. And the cop was like, don't do it. Don't do it. I was like, yeah, I'm not doing it. You know, I was like, let's just go. I want to get there. And he's like, carry on, you know, go. Go quickly. But I get to the airport, and, like, my jeans are all bloody from getting, you know, stabbed in the legs. My shirt's ripped off. And so I get dropped off. I give the little cab driver a hug, like, hang in there, buddy, you know, like. I'm out, but you're going back. You know,
That guy still drove you the rest of the way.
I knew where else to go. We were like in the hood, you know, like, yeah,
that's a dedicated driver.
But I was like, dude, you're all I got. You have to, you know, it was like either that or I'm taking your car and I'm driving to the airport. Yeah. But, I just gave him like all the money I had in my wallet. I was like, here, good luck. You know, like you're going back out there. I'm leaving, but you're staying here.
You're like,
but no, batted an eye.
Yeah, like, here's a bunch of money. You can give that to the guy with the teardrop tattoos later on when you're back.
Yeah,
when you're back on that road again.
Oh man, I felt bad. We messed up his car too, but it was surprising that when we dropped me off at the airport, like no one even batted an eye. You know, I'm sitting there with my jeans all bloody, my shirt ripped off, and everyone's just like, nah, it happens. You know, like whatever. The guy just got robbed. You know,
just another heinous crime coming through. It's fine.
Yeah, exactly. When I went to check in at the airport too, like get on the plane. My hand's still shaking. It's like all cut up and bleeding. And the guy's like, you okay? And I was like, oh man, this just happened.
I'm still going pumped up.
Yeah. He was like, careful. Got to be careful. I was like, yeah. Just let me get on the plane, man. I want to go home.
Yeah. Dude, that's wild. So getting worldly, are you going to come out with more episodes, more seasons? What's the next format? Yeah.
You know, next I'm thinking, I haven't done any of the stand countries. That's one of the areas I have. And they got some cool places there with like some crazy dictators that are just like insane. I haven't been to Serbia. I want to go to Belgrade. I hear it's awesome, fun, and cheap. So I'm going to do that too. You know, I'm going to make an episode of the 3 weeks I just spent in Turkey.
Oh, so you already collected a bunch of footage there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot. It's cool too, man. Turkey is, it's awesome. It's huge. It is huge. So there'll be a lot more episodes. any recommendations? I'd love to hear feedback from anyone on and countries they would like to see, and I'll definitely do an episode on it.
So are they all generated? Do you have any archival stuff that you kind of took more amateurishly before you had such a focus that like you could make, you could stitch into an episode?
That
takes a lot of effort though, because it's like a lot more, a lot more white space or whatever, a lot more.
Yeah. I have like a ton of just amateur weird footage of me just running around, you know, jungles and, you know, in Colombia, you know,
Dude, I cracked up when you said when you're walking behind the chick and you go, don't stop short.
Yeah.
And then she stopped short. Yeah. And then he made another Seinfeld comment later. I'm like, oh, dude, I love it. There's two Seinfeld references now.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Try to make it somewhat entertaining. Yeah. Well, you get to hear my thoughts, basically, you know.
Yeah. It's got a very journal, it's like a travel journal feel. People, go check it out. Give feedback. There's links in the show notes. Before we wrap up, I want to hear kind of your overall message to the listeners, not only with this project, but just about you made a really interesting point where you talked about hanging out with strangers that you meet at a hostel.
Yeah.
And I want to talk to you about kind of some of the learnings that you had there about the transfer of knowledge. But first, before you transfer your knowledge to the listeners and to me.
Yes.
You got a tattoo.
I did.
Not by the llama, although you were there to see his holiness. But
that's correct.
But it wasn't the llama who gave you the tattoo. But let's hear about this.
Yeah, not his holiness. Well, you know, I'm going to these places, and it's because I'm like, if I'm making a show, I'm like, I got to do something interesting. Can't just get drunk everywhere, you know, and make it like me going to the bar in every country. Although, you know, that's in there. But so I'm like, all right, I hear about this thing that you could do. You can get a tattoo. It's legal for Westerners to get. So white people can't get it. You have to be a Buddhist to get this. There's only two monks in Thailand that can give it. Like a lot of people say they get it, but it's not the real thing. Like this is like a dead serious sacred thing to do. It's called a Sakyong tattoo. And it's like, you probably heard or seen people doing it. Guy has like a hammer and he's got a stick and he just hammers a tattoo into you.
Oh my goodness.
So I'm like, perfect. I was like, I'll do that, you know.
Like, sounds like a good experience.
I was like, people will watch that, right? You know, I was like, but you don't get to pick the tattoo. So he picks the tattoo and he picks where it goes on you.
He gave you a tramp stamp, didn't he?
Dude, that's what I was, my first thought was like, oh God, please, please do not give me a tramp stamp or like on my face or my neck. It was like, yeah, if it was on my face or my neck or a tramp stamp, I don't think I would have done it. I would have stopped. But like it.
You just have one dot, one big bruise on the one, and then you'd be like, that's it, I'm done.
You know, there will be an episode about it. I won't give too much away, but you would think, you know, that it's such a sacred monk that gives you this. I had to bring them like an offering to do CS accept you. So I had to pay a bunch of people to like meet this monk, have them vouch for me, get this meeting with them, and I had to bring them stuff. And so like they don't carry money. And so what I brought them was like they gave me this stuff to bring to them, and I look at it and it's a bunch of weed. I was like, what is this real? You know, I was like, I was like, well, what's prison sentence in Thailand for, you know, like an ounce of marijuana?
For a white guy of carrying a bunch of weed too, by the way.
Yeah, they'd probably kill you. Who knows, you know? And so then I was like, and what is a monk doing smoking weed? You know, this is allegedly, I don't know that the monk smoked this weed. This is allegedly, I didn't see him do it.
Dude, you know how hard it is to live in solitude and be that peaceful without being high? I mean, come on.
Exactly. So I was happy to give it to him, man. Yeah. Some pre-rolled joints. It was like, you know, quite a few of them. I can give you a picture too of it.
Yeah, dude, do that. It's funny that there's like payola to get even to like the sacred monk. There's like all these loopholes, you know, like they don't want money, but they'll let you buy that. There's people will buy him stuff.
Exactly.
Just like when in Japan at Pachinko, it's you like can't gamble there, but you can go next door to Pachinko and pay get your chips and then go exchange those for money. It's like, come on.
That's exactly it. You know, it's like, you're not giving the monk money. You're just giving him like a bunch of stuff. And I did give him some money too, but he used it like to trade. That's what they said.
That's what all money
is. That's what money is. You literally trade it for stuff, you know? And it's like, so it's not money for him. He's not saving it. He's just using it to like bargain and trade with. I was like, oh, he's spending it. That's what money.
Oh, okay. You're spending money. You don't make, you just spend. Okay. I see. All right. I love it.
Yeah. So, I mean, so monks are, you know, they got a little naughty too. A little naughty side to them also.
Yeah.
But he accepted me to, once they give you the tattoo, they accept you to be like a little protege of them. And I could become a Buddhist monk with him. I could learn under him. I could live there and I can come back every year and get tattooed for him One's enough though, man. I'm done with it. Like it was, I have one tattoo on my side here. It took about 4.5 hours. This took 25 minutes and it hurt 10 times more. Like,
oh, yeah. Just the whole experience just condensed into one little burst of,
oh gosh, 25. I felt like such a yeah. wimp. I was like screaming and like they have two guys run up to you and hold you down. Cause like it needs to be flat. And the monk goes in like a trance. He's just going, he doesn't draw it out or nothing. So at one point he was just like, all right, turn around. Basically. And I turned around and he just started going at it. It was like, oh God, it's happening. You know, like, look out.
Yeah. I can't wait to see this episode. That sounds incredible.
Yes. I'll give you the footage too.
Okay. So yeah. You know what else sounds incredible is an entire series of you, Edgar, becoming a Buddhist monk for a year or something. Yeah. Although if you do it with the intentions of selling it as a documentary, it might not pass the smell test.
Oh man. Yeah. It'd be a lot. I don't know. I don't know if I could do it. Yeah. I'd need a lot of weed and a lot of alcohol or something, you know,
yeah.
Cause it's pretty cool though. I mean, I have a lot of respect for them and everyone in Thailand at some point of their life is like a monk, you know, but, another interesting thing about that tattoo is women can't get it because monk cannot touch women, you know, and even if like a woman brushes up against a monk in like a bus, they have to do a huge sacred thing to like get that temptation away and like spend the whole day like getting rid of that, whatever.
Jeez, Louise. Yeah. I mean,
yeah, it's a big process.
Yeah, I guess so. There, you were talking about a monk in, maybe it wasn't a monk. Where were you? Where there was that little tiny shed like on top of a mountain, a little house up there, and you said that a guy comes down.
Oh yeah, that was Georgia.
Was that Georgia? Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
That would have been cool if you would have. I know you said you had the opportunity to meet him, but you had like other plans that day. You couldn't do it. But.
Yeah, I really wanted to, man. I just wanted to see who he was. You know, like, hey, I've heard about you. You know, thank you. You know,
you have this like serene picture in your head, but it's some guy with like a Randy Savage t-shirt and like Oakleys and like a mullet. You know,
how funny would that be? Yes, just living up there, just chilling.
What's up, man? You watched the new season of Narcos, or?
Yeah. And he comes down. You know, people bring him food. He comes down, and what he does is, you can hear in the episode, he kind of mentors troubled youth. You know, so if someone's not doing so good or anything, it's like, hey, talk to the old man. You know, up there.
Yeah, he's like the wisdom keeper.
Yeah, exactly. But does something positive. So with that,
let's talk about you made the comment in one of the, in episode 3, I think, or episode 2, about meeting people in hostels, and you do kind of a quick download with these people that are, you're very, it's very much a passing relationship. Of course, now with social media, you may have an opportunity to keep in touch with them, but that's not really the point. It's more about you're living there with that person for the day. You're transferring each other's knowledge, downloading and uploading accordingly, and then you go your separate ways. Talk about the spiritual impact on that and kind of how that restored your faith and humanity, if you will.
You explain that very well, because that's exactly what it is. You know, you're going in these, and that's a fun part about hostels too, you know, and you're meeting some of the most interesting people that have done incredible things.
People that are also willing to go travel too, without really having a bunch of plans. That's a certain qualifier already that makes them cool.
It really is. You know, so you'll meet a certain type of person that's willing to put themselves in this position. That's just like, all right, let's go. You know, it's like, yeah. So you meet some of the coolest people, and that's definitely, like you said, it's a knowledge transfer, you know, and it is a passing relationship that, you know, we talk to each other and it's like, all right, you know, where are you coming from? Where'd you go? And then you learn on like, what's the best way to do things. You learn how not to get ripped off. You learn, you know, what should you do, what you shouldn't do, what's some cool things to do, you know, better ideas. And then we just kind of like talk about experiences, because everyone you meet in a hostel, they're doing the same thing you've done. And it's, they're way more interesting than me. What I should make most of the show on is people I meet. You know, I've met so many cool people that have done just incredible, unbelievable things, you know, and it's really interesting. Like you say, you know, it's a passing relationship. So you spend, you know, 24 or 48 hours, you have the best time of your life with these people. And it's like, goodbye.
Forever. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Although I have met up with a lot of people, you know, I would think it would just be a passing relationship, but I do keep in touch with quite a bit.
Oh yeah. Lot, it's easier, you know, to do that now. Yeah. You actually can.
Especially now, you know, back like 5-8 years ago, not as much, but now it's like, yeah. And it's so simple, especially with social media and everything. It's like, you know, hit some people up and it's like, hey, I'm headed to Egypt next week. You know, want to join? And then they'll be like, yep, I'll see you there. You know? Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So it's special though. And I think people would love that. And it's, you know, people from all shapes, sizes, different styles of life. But I think if you travel too, you're open. You're open and you're open to adjusting, you know, and not kind of stuck in your way. And so Yeah, it definitely, you learn a lot from each other, and it's cool. So it's my favorite part of traveling, I think.
Yeah, I think that's so cool. So and I think here's the moneymaker question.
All right.
You got to the point where you were a cybersecurity executive.
Yes.
That's a high stress, high reward, high stress, but sterile exactly. job, I guess. You know, I mean, yes. like it's, you know, it's controlled environment, although you're dealing with chaos and whatnot, but mm-hmm. you decided you had enough of that. You woke up basically. It's maybe,
yes.
you
know,
so the question is now that you've experienced a year and a half, basically of solid travel, mm-hmm. You lost your grandfather in there. Unfortunately, he's a close guy with you, but now that gave you the opportunity to go reconnect again in Malta, yeah. which is beautiful. You're there now. The question is, did that, whatever that itch was that came up, did you scratch it, or what's the plan? Do you see yourself in the executive corner office again someday?
Oh man, I don't know. I scratched it, but it itches still, you know, and it's,
it itches more now, right?
It does. And I think it depends on how well it does throughout the film fest circuit. And, you know, if people do like it and it's worth doing, then yeah, definitely. It'd be like my dream to keep doing this. And I think, you know, I've got a lot of great feedback, and I love just sharing the experiences and, you know, other people's experiences and kind of what's out there, give a different view of it. So I definitely plan on keeping it going. But could I see myself going back to corporate America? I feel horrible saying this and selling out, but yes.
Yeah, yeah, because I think, you understand, you know, that there's a possibility. Yeah, that might be mm-hmm. required, but it may look different though. Maybe it's you in corporate America slinging your documentary though, or something, you know.
Yes, yeah.
That
yeah,
element exactly. of your background is still going to make you very valuable now, even if you were to go this creative route.
Yeah, thank you.
So I think I don't see any reason why you wouldn't continue to do it. I think you talked about it a little bit, how you don't really have any credibility on this first set. You know, so you, yeah. you know, you walk into a place and you try to get an interview. It's not going to be the same as if Anthony Bourdain, RIP, did it.
Of course not. Yeah.
But yeah. Now that you have this on film, if you will, you know, that's just, you're going to continue to grow exactly. it. To be honest with
It'd
you,
it'd be so much easier, I think, too. You know, because there's very skeptical. It's like, you know, who's this little bald guy that wants to shove a camera in my face?
Right.
I have zero credibility. You know, right. but yes.
Yeah, just showing it on there. That's a huge first step. So and of course, it's doing well in the festivals. I'm not surprised. Just like you appreciate the knowledge transfer that happens when you meet a stranger in a foreign country. That's very much how this feels, you know, and that's what yeah. I liked about it. That's really what the show felt like to me, was you learned a bunch of stuff because of your travel. It's not that you did a thesis yeah. or that you went into some giant research project, but you learned enough about it to be dangerous, and you transferred yeah. that around. You in each episode, I noticed you made a point to talk about a specific app, a cell phone app that would help travel, you know, new travelers. I think that's a really cool.
Yeah.
You're sharing your knowledge. You're giving it away for free, essentially. We appreciate it. People watch it. Let Edgar know what you think. And dude, best of luck, man. And by the way, I have a full sound studio here. If you ever need like support audio wise, I'm happy to support it for just on the house because of your willingness awesome. To come on the show.
Thank you so much, man. Yeah. I really enjoyed talking to you too. And I think you explained that so well too. I really appreciate everything. Appreciate you having me on the show. Anything I can do to help, how about you too?
Man, oh yeah, dude, let's yeah. When you're in town next time, you're in back in Michigan, I'll make sure let's try to hook up.
And
I'll
in America, maybe studio. Like 2 years or something, huh?
Yeah, they who
let
knows?
Me back in, who knows? Yeah.
who knows? By then you're gonna dude, be all tatted. Mother, you're gonna have all these face tattoos by then.
When I left, my mother was like, "Well, I'll see you in 2 years, huh?" I was like, "What do you mean? Like, they're not gonna let you back in?" I was like, "You might be right."
No, it sounded like a joke at first, but now it's like, ooh.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe not. Yes, but yeah, dude, definitely, man.
Edgar, dude, what a blast, man. I had such a good time. Thank you for coming on. Thank you for the kind words. Keep it rolling, dude. It's inspiring. I see good things for you, dude. It's awesome. Thanks so much.
Hey, thank you so much. And I love your show too. And I really love how the platform you have here and how comfortable you make people feel. And good. You know,
well, thank
appreciate
you,
everything.
I appreciate it, man. Peace out.
Yeah, I'll see you.
That is going to do it for this week's episode. 82 of these bad boys in the books. Thank you so much, Edgar, for coming on. Thanks for sharing your stories. People, go check it out. It's in the show notes. It's free if you're a Prime member. And hey, if you're not a Prime member, well, why not? And B, join up for a lot of reasons, including getting worldly. Peace out, y'all.
Yeah, it's been a minute, but I'm back in it. Y'all ain't dealing with the same bar.
No.
Got a little trippy, then the transition.
Yeah.
New attitude mixed with the pure raw. The night game, your girl called. She like, do me, baby, down to get busy.
Yes.
No dice, chill with it.
No.
In life, feeling dizzy.
war. Having visits of the city and I go to war. See me in the day through the late night. Tell him it's the charm, I'm in freeze mode. To the gods, can't stop a hero when he in flight. I'm swimming in the light, right? Go and get you some, go and show him something. It's a new thing. Yeah, let my nuts hang. Knock a top off like LeBron or the Wayne Wade. Oh, lift off. Can't start a nigga grow, better get gone, move along. You don't wanna trip, wanna get it on. You don't wanna act, don't get me wrong. They don't listen to the words in the song. We ain't gotta tell them, we're just getting ready. See in front, we ain't kidding. If you want it, you can get it. Members of the rage, come and get you some. Next steps of the jet from the lean back. Run around the world and we ain't packed. Hit them boom, boom, leave them stuck. Oh, you seen that? Chillin' with a team at. See a black band, pull up with some drums. Yeah, I need that. So crazy, you can't believe it. No cams, damn, no filming at all. Real nigga facts.
Come on.
Years ago, rehab, all good. Help me figure out another plan. It got bad, so bad. Nah, I ain't fucking love that man. Then I hopped out in the new zone with my Louis bag. Two story, take you through the dark and the light.
Yeah.
Got sun, got through new. Back up in the world, it's a day in the life. Hit the blunt and get it.
Dude.
Raise bars, same song, we did it.
Yeah.
Hot sauce poured on all jams. It's busy, carry on, smoke strong. Get your mama down with it.
Come on.
And the game fucking needed something dirty raw. Tell them it's the law and we read it.
Yeah.
So if it's God you believe in,
yeah.
Bob your head and just nod in agreement.
Yeah,
they say time's undefeated. I'ma be the first one who can beat it.
Yeah.
I had hoop dreams, yeah. Now I shoot threes.
What?
Got a little green,
yeah.
But I don't do weed. No perp nor lean,
nah.
That's Toonchi,
yeah.
That's Norleans.
What?
Fuck Drew Brees,
yeah.
Snoop deal double, that's 2 G's,
yeah.
Probably spin on paper, ooh-wee. Since Tuesday, probably killed a few trees,
yeah.
But the only ones I smoke are the loose leaf. Not high, but I'm your highness.
What?
And secretly, you're my dick,
yeah.
But you haters, a butt hurt, bunch of sore hind ends. I was just a poor white kid,
yeah.
Now if rap was beatball, I'd be Jordan-like, bitch.
What?
You wish you could score like this, yeah. Not even at half court I'd miss.
Nah.
A mouthwash, cause if I was on the floor I'd swish.
Chloride,
swish. But I cannot lie,
nah.
I got you in my top 5 worst rappers of all time. I lost my spot, y'all got all time. King of rap, nah, their words, not mine,
yeah.
King of swear words, and not lying,
yeah.
You should never compare yours,
nope.
A toll free number,
yeah.
Only way you'll ever have a hotline. Fuck's going on, man?
Yeah, huh?
Bunch of half-wits up in office. Half of us walking around like a zombie apocalypse. Other half of us pissed off and don't wanna wear a mask and they're just scoffing. And that's how you end up catching the shit off them. I just use the same basket as you shopping. Now I'm in a fucking casket from you coughing. Always stay ahead of haters, let them hate, but never let a traitor penetrate your circle. Separate yourself from those who try to pull you down. The real ones never stray. It's sorta like Medusa, that's how you stay ahead of snakes. MCs pull out gats, I don't give a fuck how strapped. You're gonna out rap me, I doubt that. Please, bitch, I'm a house rat. These raps about that cheese like mousetraps. Earthlings, I adapt to them. Certain things I don't wanna do but have to, in order just to act human, like using a bathroom and vacuuming. Yeah, rapping in the booth in a triple fat goose hazmat suit, bubble wrap and a mask too. And I don't think that's what they meant by trap music. Running through ink like I'm tattooing. This is music to be murdered by your love. Turn the volume up, I am fired up like a blunt. Bread is long like an Italian's up. I am drugs, that is probably why your opinion of me's high as fuck. And it's non-stop fury,
cause
I ain't holding them up like an armed robbery. God's my jury, so when I die, I'm not worried. Prayers to George Floyd and Ahmaud Arbery. How the fuck is it that so many cops are dirty? Stop, man, please, officer, I'm sorry, but I can't breathe when I got you on top of me. Your goddamn knees and my carotid artery.
The adventures of Moon Man and Slim. Yes, who wanted with them? The trilogy continues. Seven niggas, yes, it was on the menu. Watch them panic, god damn it.
Let's get it, baby.
Hope you fuckers understand it. The real up for you niggas. Come and get descriptions.
Yeah.
Rap God,
cool.
Rage.